welcome to the Sessions Legend Series, and we are truly honored to be joined today by the great Denny Seiwell. Now, you may not know a lot about Denny, but I'm sure you know him from his work with Paul McCartney, and we're going to talk a little bit about that. We're also going to talk a little about some of the other guys he's played with and some of his experiences in the business. So welcome, Denny.
Thanks, Paul. Great to be here.
And thank you so much for coming out and talking to us. We appreciate
pleasure.
It.
I love everything about Sessions and Jules and the work that she's doing. It's really some good stuff.
Well, and we're grateful for you. So tell us, generally, how did your relationship with music begin?
Well, my relationship with music began with my father. We had a lot of musicians in our family. We had an uncle, Puss Ronimus, who played trombone. We had another uncle that played, Numa Snyder. He was a violinist. And my grandfather's brother, Bunny Snyder, was a great trumpet player in New York and around the country. And he worked with a lot of the major stars way back in the 20s and 30s, you know. So my dad was a drummer, and he played with big bands in the area. And he actually played with Tommy Dorsey at one point. Just, you know, they were local. It was a local band before Tommy and Jimmy Dorsey made it big. So when I was 3 years old, I was sitting next to my dad up at, I forget the name of the place, but the big band would play, and I'd sit and watch him play big band music, so I loved it. That was my initiation.
And so, first of all, it's amazing to me how often great players have been exposed to music when they're young.
Very young, yeah.
Whether it's parents or family friends, right. But would it be fair to say you were kind of immersed in music then?
They gave me a drum when I was one. For my first birthday, I took the stick, I went through the top head, and then I took the stick, went through the bottom head, and they took it away from me.
So nothing's changed, really?
Nothing's changed, no. But when I was five, I used to play a lot, you know, when I was a kid, but when I was seven, they enrolled me. My town had a little thing called the Lehighton Boys Band, and for 50 cents a week, you got a group lesson with a bunch of other drummers, kids your age, from this fellow who was wonderful, Professor Charles Fronheiser. He had a pencil thin mustache. He was a great guy. And then once a week you got to play with like 40 other kids your age playing marches and stuff like this. You're reading music. And then by the time I was like nine, I was playing with the older kids, so I had two nights a week playing in a little marching band, concert band situation and reading music, which was awesome, and got a group lesson at least every week, you know. So that was the thing that started me off.
So was it always going to be the drums for you?
Yeah, always. But by the time I was 13, I'd read every drum book that was written at the time through the Boys Band Association. And Professor Fronheiser used to give me take something home. Here's how you play a clarinet. So he showed me how to play a clarinet. I have a clarinet. And here's how you finger a trumpet. So I learned how to play the trumpet. I started on piano, but I didn't like that at all. But I can play a little piano, a little trumpet, a little reeds, you know, saxes and all that. But it was incredible. My whole life was around music when I was a kid. And I knew at nine that it was either football or music, and I was terrible at football. So,
so music it was.
Yeah, music it was.
So, you grew up in New York, right?
Yes.
And whereabouts in New York did you grow up? And was it a particular
musical
area?
No, I'm from Pennsylvania,
okay,
which is 2 hours away. But as soon as I got out of the service, went to New York to start my career.
And let's talk about that, because you were in the Navy?
Yeah, in the Navy Band.
And the Navy Band?
A Navy Band. There's plenty of them around the world. But I was stationed in, went to the school in Washington, D.C. They have a Navy School of Music that was awesome. And then we went to South America and a cream of the crop students from the band. We did a USIS tour that was awesome back in the 60s. And then I got stationed in France, the south of France, for the Admiral of the Sixth Fleet. And that's where I met my wife. She didn't even know I was in the Navy because it used to make the tourists mad when we played the Star Spangled Banner on the back of the boat in the morning. You know, we'd raise a flag and it'd wake them up in these fancy hotels in the harbor. So they asked the Admiral to stop that horrible noise in the morning. So we had 4 days off at a time being in the Navy. So I had an apartment in Nice, civilian clothes. I'd just show up to the ship and say, I'm still alive. And when the ship left, we'd go along with the ship. We'd do concert tours and stuff when the ship went into port. So that was my, you know, the Navy wasn't bad for me. I did a lot of traveling, a lot of playing all over South America and and all over Europe too. It's Northern Africa and everything. It was cool.
That sounds fantastic.
Yeah, it was. It was cool stuff. But then I went to write to New York to start my career.
And you knew at that stage, even when you got out of the Navy, that was what you were going to do.
Yeah, I couldn't wait.
Now, we talk a lot in the sessions about people that inspire us, and I think you've already mentioned certainly people who were a musical inspiration to you growing up, whether it was your father or family members or teachers. How did that musical inspiration carry through to what you wanted to do when you got to New York?
Well, I heard certain drummers. I heard a lot of drummers, but I was a late bloomer as far as jazz and that whole world. And while I was in the Navy band, there was a lot of guys that used to, you know, bring records along. We had a little band room, and I heard Elvin Jones on record once, and that just blew me away. Then I heard a guy named Mel Lewis.
Okay.
So Elvin's animal veracity, shall we say, and Mel Lewis's taste, they were the two things that I just kind of melded into my style. And these were the guys that I really respected the most at the time, you know. And later on, I got to meet Elvin. I actually, as a kid, went into the city one night, and he was playing there, and I asked if I could sit in with his band.
That's pretty brave.
That's really stupid. But he said, sure, kid. So he played a drum solo at the end of the set. He said, here's the sticks.
Follow that?
Oh, follow that. And I did. I just got up and played. And we were outside hanging out, having a good time. And he's throwing me up in the air and everything. He says, you're all right. You can play the drums, man. I really like the way you play the drums. And now we see this guy walking down the street. It was a bad neighborhood. And this guy looked like he was going to rob us. You know, it was really, I was scared. And the guy gets closer. Elvin sees him. He says, hey, come on over. He invites him over. Oh, boy, now we're in trouble. He says, Denny, I want you to meet Art Blakey.
So you thought you might get mugged by Art Blakey?
Yeah. I mean, he was in one of his bad periods. He really looked bad. But so Elvin was very, and Mel Lewis, he was, if you spell Lewis backwards, it spells Seiwell, by the way. He was like my dad. He would, in New York, he got me my deal with Gretsch Drums.
Okay.
And I got the honor of playing with the Thad Jones Mel Lewis Big Band. On occasion, when Mel would have to work, he'd call me and I'd get to play the first or second set with the big band on a Monday night at the Village Vanguard. So that was you couldn't get any better than that.
Now, I love that story because one of the things we talk about to young musicians who are up and coming is seizing the moment.
Yeah.
And I mean, it may have made a difference in your career if you hadn't felt brave enough at that moment to go and sit in with Elvin.
Yeah.
And so, but you seize the moment, and I mean, other than developing a relationship with Elvin and meeting up, Blakey, what came from that?
Everything. I mean, just the courage to get up and sit in. In those days, sitting in happened. Today, I mean, everything is so structured, there's no sitting in. I mean, maybe a little bit here
and
there.
Yeah, but certainly much harder.
Yeah. And in those days, I mean, you'd go into a club or something, and they knew you were a player, and hey, you want to play a tune. And sometimes that's all it took, you know. I was doing a gig in the mountains where we're playing singer, dance team, comedian, you know, and it was a great little band, but on the weekends, they'd augment the band with all the session guys from New York would come up to play for the big celebrity stars and stuff. And one time, a contractor came up and heard my drumming and the show stuff, and he said, wow, you're really good for you. Come on into the city. I'll get you plugged into the recording world. That's how I got my first record dates, through Russ Savakis, who was a contractor and a bass player. You know, so it's funny how you kind of tumble into these situations, but you have to be courageous enough to just put yourself in the path for something good to happen, you know.
Now, how did you develop the versatility, though, that you became there? Because really, from what you've told us right now, if we knew nothing else about you other than what you just said, we would think you were a straight-ahead jazz guy.
Yeah, I was.
Well, but you...
Well, I'll tell you what changed, though. When I was in South America, and that was 1964, or 63 even, I'm not sure, but I heard Brazilian music for the first time in Brazil. And straight eighth, I really fell in love with this, you know, because it wasn't the spang-a-lang, the dang, dang, ga dang. It wasn't jazz, yet it was jazz, but it was straight eighth. And so when the rock and roll commerciality of rock and roll started hitting TV. TV commercials went from kind of swing music over to that light rock, you know, because of the samba stuff and the Brazilian music, I fit right into that mold. And a lot of the older jazz guys couldn't play that straight stuff. They had too much swing in the style. So that's the way I got led into the rock and roll thing. And my gig with McCartney was my first rock and roll gig.
Let's talk about that. How did you get that gig?
Well, through working at the Half Note with guys like Al Cohn and Zoot Sims playing jazz 6 nights a week, everybody would come down and they'd say, "Who's the new kid in town?" Sunday nights, I would get heard and exposed to all of the heavies in New York. And your name floats around. Pretty soon you start getting calls for record dates and TV commercials and all that. Now you're in the studio world. And I rose up to the top because of that straight eight thing that I could do, which was becoming fashionable at the time. Now McCartney comes to town to do the Ram album, and he calls a guy named Barry Kornfeld. And Barry had a list of the best drummers, or the guys that were doing that kind of level work. And I was on that list, because I'd made it to that position. So he called this audition, and we didn't even know it was an audition. My service called and said, "Hey, Barry wants you to do a demo with him." And I just had a session cancel out, so I said, "I don't know if I have time for a demo today." "Yeah, okay, what the heck." So I take it, I get to the building, and it's not even a studio. It's just a brownstone about to be torn down way over on the west side. And I said, "Oh, this sounds fishy. I might get mugged here or something, you know." So I go in, and there's a guy sitting there at the desk, and I said, "Is there a studio here?" And he goes, "Basement." Oh man, this is gonna be dangerous. I walk down in this basement. There's just a dirt floor, a set of drums, Paul and Linda McCartney sitting over in the corner.
By the way, just as an aside, have you noticed that good things seem to happen to you when you think you're about to get mugged?
Yeah.
Just an observation. Anyway, sorry, go ahead. Paul
and Linda. So I said, "Hey, you're Paul McCartney." He goes, "Yeah, I'm Paul McCartney. How are you, man?" I said, "Well, what's up?" He said, "Well, I'm gonna make a record here in town. I'm looking at some drummers. You mind playing for me?" "Yeah, sure, I mind playing for you. I mean, buy my record, you know."
Yeah.
So I said, "Yeah, what do you want to hear?" So there was a ratty old set of drums there, and I had some tom-toms with me. I used to carry two tom-toms with me. And most of the studios had their own drums, but I had better toms. I used to bring them along. So I said, "You want me to play on these things?" He said, "Yeah." So I said, "Do you mind if I set my toms up?" "Okay." So I set my toms up. He said, "I said, you got a bass or a guitar or something?" He says, "No, just you." "Okay, well, what do you want to hear?" So he said, "Well, just play some rock and roll time." So I said, "Okay, I'm going to be Ringo." So I went, bah, 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 I went right for the tom-toms, you know. And I think it was my attitude as well as what I played. But he said, "Play some shuffle, play a little of this, a little of that." And I did. And I was there 10, 15 minutes max. He said, "Great, man. Thanks for playing for us. And we'll talk." So I left. I knew, I don't even have a chance. This is the biggest guy on the planet right now.
Absolutely.
And I said, "I'll never get this phone call." And then I heard, they all went down there. They say they didn't go down to the audition, but they all went down there, right? So I'm at home a couple days later, and the phone rings, you know. Pick up the phone, and it's Paul. You know,
It's not his manager.
It's not his manager. It's not his agent. Not anybody. But hey, it's Paul. "Oh, hello. How you doing?" He said, "Hey, I want to book you for this record. Can you start next week?" And I said, "Just give me a second. Let me look at my book." And I just closed the book, jumped straight up in the air, and I said, "Yeah, I think I can do that, man." So he started. He booked me for the first week. Donald McDonald, a wonderful drummer, for the second week. And a guy named Herb Lavelle, one of the great soul drummers, for the third week. And I was thrilled. I was just absolutely thrilled. Went to work the first day at the CBS. You know, Paul walks in, and I have the Beatles drum set, too, that I got at an auction. In the midst of meeting him and starting the Ram dates, the Museum of Famous People went out of business, and they had Ringo's Shea Stadium kit there. And the guy at the drum shop bought it. Got them at auction and sold them to me. So Paul says, "Hey man, how you doing?
Do you still have it?"
No.
Okay, just checking out.
He said, that your drums? And he did a double take when he saw the Beatles drum kit there in the drum booth. And we started working, and after the first day or so, he said, you know what, this is good. And he let the other two guys go, and he hired me for 6 weeks to finish Ram, 9 o'clock to 6 o'clock every day, banker's hours.
Back the old EMI tradition.
Yeah. And they'd come in at 10:30, you know, but I was there at 9 o'clock ready to work, and sometimes we'd leave early. So it was one of the most rewarding experiences of my recording career, though. I mean, every day, we'd do a song a day, and every day he would come in with another song that he just said, wow, this music will be heard. Timeless music, you know, and you know, they just reissued Ram last year.
He was worried about it, wasn't he? I mean, I remember reading at the time that...
Well, it got slagged when it first came out. The critics did not like it, but everybody's saying he left the Beatles. You know, he left our band. He broke up our band, and we're not going to like anything that he does anyway. But over time, they saw that this is one of his best writing periods. As far as I'm concerned, I made maybe a couple hundred records over the years, and nothing like Ram. That was amazing. And the procedure, I mean, when he'd play us a song, we'd work out our parts. It was just, Paul would play either guitar or piano and a pilot vocal. Spinoza or McCracken would be the guitar player and me, and we would just work out the song, find our parts. He didn't dictate parts by any means. He gave us full free rein to find our parts and then start doing takes. And we usually had a song done by 2:30, 3 o'clock, go break for lunch, and sometimes he'd let us go early, and it was amazing.
And that parlayed into at some later stage, right? That parlayed into you going on the road with...
Yeah, well, a couple months after Ram was out, he called and said, would you like to come to England and hang out? Bring your wife, go take a little vacation. So we're over there, and he says, I miss playing in a band, so want to join a band? Let's put a band together. I said, yeah, okay. I'm working 18 hours a day in New York, so it was a hard pace to keep up with. And I said, well, this is going to pay a lot of money, too. So that's it. Let's go. Man, I packed everything up in New York, moved to London. We formed Wings, started recording and touring and all that stuff. And it was supposed to be a band effort. We were all part of a band, you know. Like, this guy's the Beatle and we're just some musicians. But we were all going to be shareholders in this band. It was pretty amazing. Great opportunity.
One of the things that made the Beatles special anyway, because they were all down-to-earth guys.
Yeah, absolutely. And then we started out with the university tour. No gigs booked, no hotels booked. We had a 12-passenger van and a truck for the equipment. We'd set out and find a place to play, a college to play. And it was funny, sometimes we'd pull into a college, like, we'd do a show here tonight, and they said, well, the kids are having finals, it's not really not a good time. Well, we got Paul McCartney out there in the van. And we go, yeah, right, so we drag him out, and Paul go, hey, how are you?
And suddenly they'd find room to have him play.
That was awesome.
Presumably, having the Paul McCartney thing on your resume led to you getting other work afterwards.
Yeah. Although you play with a Beatle, it really messes up your jazz career.
There's probably not many people booking you for the straight ahead jazz gig after. No. But I'm sure there were other opportunities that looked pretty good, and you played with Art Garfunkel, right?
Yeah, that was much later out here in L.A. I did the Art Garfunkel Breakaway album. But one of the benefits that came was Billy Joel.
Right.
Michael Lang asked me, he said, I got this new artist. I'd like for you to hear the kid, and if you like him, I want you to produce him. So I said, yeah, okay, send me the demo. I heard the demo, and we went right into Ultrasound in Long Island. We started recording Cold Spring Harbor. And about halfway through that, Paul says, hey, we're forming a band. I need you in London now. So I left. I just left that project. But, you know, things like Billy Joel and
Rick Danko,
James Brown. I was doing a session with James Brown. I'll never forget, James came in. I know you play with Paul McCartney, but when you play with James Brown band, I got to hear one, tick, 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 one of them. And all of a sudden, the whole band just went right to James Brown's band. It was amazing. That was a track on the Goodfoot album called Funky Side of Town.
I'm going to check that out when I get out of here.
It was great, yeah.
Now, you also, you know, I think the background you have with reading and with the jazz background and the rock and roll background led you into doing movies and TV, right?
Yeah.
So you've done quite a few movie soundtracks.
Mm-hmm.
hard gigs to get and hard gigs to hold down.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of people playing music at any given time.
When you have a 110-piece symphony orchestra, we were doing Waterworld one day, and it was, every other bar was a different time signature, 7, 8, 5, 8, 3, 8, 1, 4, you know. And I'm just like, the click is going all over the place, and I'm counting to myself, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. Oh my God, and you screw it up once, and 110 guys turn around and look at you and say, oh man, you can't count, and we got to do that damn thing again, you know. Yeah, it's fun stuff, but it's. I'm glad I had classical training that I could actually do that kind of stuff. Not many rock and roll guys get called in on that kind of stuff.
Okay, as you know, the Sessions spends a lot of time talking to young kids about what they do in the music business. As we close, I wonder what advice you could give someone young, starting out in the industry right now, about what they need to know about the way the business works.
Well, right now is different than it used to be. All you needed then was talent. And we did things on a hippie handshake. very, very few contracts were made in those days. So what you need today, besides being complete at your craft, understanding everything that they want and what your job is there, there's so many things to understand. The business of music. I mean, right now, kids are going to college to learn the business of music, so they don't make a lot of the mistakes that a lot of us made in those days. Plus, you have to have complete knowledge of electronics, recording, your gear, how, you know, everything. Today, it's a different ballgame. You must be more prepared because, you know, how many, there's millions of kids out there that want to make a living at music, and a handful is going to make it. So that you got to work so much harder these days.
And knowing those business sides, that gives you a leg up, gives you a chance of being in that handful, right?
Well, you know when to say, hey man, this just isn't right. We gotta talk about this, you know. Today with songwriting, downloading music, and all of the stuff that goes on business-wise, you have to have a big picture understanding of the whole world in order to succeed. It takes more than talent today.
It does. Denny, thank you very much for your time. Thanks for stopping by.
Pleasure.
Always a pleasure. Pleasure's all mine. Thanks for listening. We'll see you next time.